Dear Chris, thank you very much for this flattening introduction, which I don't deserve, but I would be curious to read those reports. Friends, colleagues, thank you very much for listening to me, inviting me. This morning I badly injured my foot, so my choice was emergency room or this keynote. I chose the keynote, but so forgive me if I'm not 100% in shape. Chris, I think I can be relatively succinct and allow a little bit of questions, or would you like me to just go on and on and on? Wow, okay, I thought so. So I'm invited to deliver you a keynote on the data economy. Now, last week has been quite a topical week for the future of the digital economy and society in Europe, because for the first time ever, the leaders, the heads of state and government met and discussed one day, really one day, because I was there witnessing this, the digital society and economy. And I mean, for those of you that are a bit seasoned but still enthusiastic in the sector, it's really a premiere, I imagine, also for Fabio. Seeing all the European leaders discussing this was quite refreshing. And they took quite an interest on all the subjects that were discussed, the future of government, the future of economy, artificial intelligence. And on data, I mean, it's interesting what they concluded. They said that it's very important that the EU has the world's best enabling framework of access and reuse of data for innovative products and services, including for the development of artificial intelligence solutions, while maintaining a high level of ethics, data protection, and digital rights. So that's my starting point, of course. Now, first of all, if you want to call a data space an economy, I think the data have to flow. I mean, the data have to be exchanged, because otherwise, I mean, it's difficult that you can make something, I mean, out of something that does not circulate. So that's why the starting point for us of any discussion about the data economy in Europe is to make sure that there's free flow of data. So this, of course, requires regulatory intervention. Probably you will see in my speech, these are one of the few areas where heavy-handed regulatory intervention is needed, whilst in other areas like ownership, we will be relatively prudent in launching ourselves in a regulatory exercise. But starting with the free flow, so the dream, the idea is that, I mean, inside Europe and possibly then outside Europe, whenever, I mean, the conditions are the right one, we should guarantee free flow of data. And, I mean, data happen to be, when you look at them a little bit closer, of two kinds, or at least, I mean, that's the way the species in Europe are classified. I mean, the personal data and the non-personal data. So the non-personal data typically are machine-generated data. Personal data is self-evident what they are. Now, we basically approached the problem of free flow data from these two different angles. On one side, from mid next year, the General Data Protection Regulation will kick in, that will ensure that wherever you are in Europe, there will be the same data protection rules. Hence, there will be no justification for localization of data on the basis of personal data protection. Of course, this is one side of the story. The other side is machine-generated data, robot-generated data, sensors. In this case, the General Data Protection Regulation does not help. That's why we complemented it with a regulation that we have presented few weeks ago, which is the free flow on non-personal data. So you have to look at the two together, interworking together, because the regulation we have presented basically says there shall be no restriction in the localization of data inside the Union, only exception being national security as defined by the treaty. Which means basically that companies will be free to optimize data flows, data processing in Europe according to their needs. This is really an important step. The impact analysis that we have to do when we present legislation in Europe, we have found some 60 already existing restrictions which are in place at regional, national level on data flows, which is an alarming trend. So you also may be aware that 16 heads of state and government signed a letter to the President of the Commission asking for this measure to be taken. So this is the step we have taken that together with the GDPR will allow free flow of data in Europe. It's a very important piece of legislation, but not that long, because what really counts, as I said, is the principle. Of course, one point which I must underline, which is of course the recurring issue about data flows, that free flow of data does not change the responsibility of the data subject. So if a company has to produce data for taxation reasons in a given jurisdiction, still is obliged to do that. And cannot say, my obligation is in Denmark, but my data are in Spain, I lost the data in Spain, I don't have an obligation anymore in Denmark. On the contrary, the company remains fully liable vis-a-vis the Danish authorities about taxation data, remains fully liable of presenting the data in the format that the Danish law requires. But remains totally free, will be totally free to optimize data centers and data processing in the best possible way. So that's a little bit the first step. So to create a data space in Europe which allows for the free flow and data processing everywhere in Europe. The second element of building a data economy is, of course, the issue about sharing those data, sharing those data among different constituencies. In Europe, there's quite a solid framework, and of course, Europe is not the only area where we have this solid framework about open data, open government data. And of course, in the G7, there are examples, Australia, we have examples in the United States, in Japan, a bit everywhere about open data. And the whole philosophy being if data are accumulated with public investment, with some exceptions, but the general rule should be that those data are available for everyone, for using those data for app developers, companies to improve their product and services. So we have been working in open data legislation since a while, and we are now, second generation of this legislation, which mandates opening of public data in a number of sectors. And still, we are reflecting what to do, but that is for the final part of my speech, so I'll give you a little bit of suspense here. This is for public data. What about privately owned data? So what about, for instance, the data generated by a car to be used by a third party? Is there any obligation to share those data? I mean, in the real world, the physical world, there are industry practices. For instance, there are automotive practices about how to share information between car manufacturers and parts owners. In the digital world, those practices still have to be developed. And this is, for instance, something that has been very much debated at the G7, which also took place last week, where different experiences coming from Japan, coming from United States, were a little bit confronted to see how to go about it. And I would say there's a generic consensus, generalized consensus that we should not rush into legislating the ownership of data. We did an extensive public consultation here in Europe. And the signal from industries is very, very clear. I mean, industries are not really demanding that we rush into legislation about ownership and reuse of data. The reason being that there are many, many different business models around sharing data, and they are basically generated by the day. So having an heavy-handed intervention from public powers at this point in time, we have recorded that everyone agrees that this is not the right thing to do. And this is probably the message we get more or less from all sectors. Now, at the same time, there are voices which are relatively loud, like, for instance, the voices of the innovation community, the small and medium enterprises, the startups, that of course have an asymmetric position vis-a-vis data. They badly need data to innovate, to propose very, very innovative application. Take fintech as an example. But at the same time, they don't have the market power to have those data. So there's an asymmetry which one should reflect if we need to do a bit more to favor that small and medium enterprises have a better access to data. Of course, fostering in a soft regulatory fashion contract models, best practices is probably the way to go. At the same time, there are issues which attract the public interest. For instance, take again car data generated by automated cars or connected cars, now connected, in the future automated. Those data are very valuable for public authorities because they allow to optimize traffic flows, allow to improve safety of the road conditions. Do we need a bit of a gentle or less gentle push that public authorities get hold of this data? The same applies for health data collected by all sorts of intelligence and gadgets we have around our body these days, smart watches or smart whatever. In aggregate, those data are very valuable to understand, health trend in the population. So, let's say, sharing those data between the private community and public community, there's a clear positive externality in terms of the social value of doing this. The point being, to what extent this shall be forced or shall be gently accompanied by law, to what extent this can be done by best practices. And of course, I'm very interested to hear also what is your opinion. That's why my speech will be short. Where we stand is, first of all, we understood that this problem is exactly the reverse of the problem that many governments have solved for years. So the problem I explained before, opening public data. So open data culture in the world is basically about opening data that are held by public authorities. Now we have the reverse problem. Large corporations having data, and now those data, should be somehow shared, especially with public authorities, for the common interest. And to what extent there should be a regulatory intervention. You can take all those problems horizontally, so say rules should be applicable no matter what is the application, or a little bit more going vertical, looking at the health sector, the automotive sector. And I don't think there's a rule I can suggest whether to go just horizontal or just to go vertical. Of course, if issues are about free flow data, you go horizontal. This applies to every sector. If issues are really related with certain industries, take in particular, industry we are working intensively with, which is the automotive industry, then probably there are industry-specific issues. The same applies to the health sector. The health sector also poses certain type of challenges. You are aware of cases of public authorities which have concluded deals, exclusivity deals, with private companies. And you wonder, whether, I mean, data which are generated by patients, which, I mean, belong in terms of the aggregated knowledge to the community, can be exclusively ceded to a particular organization. This, of course, it's a challenge on its own and requires a lot of attention. The last point I want to make is about standards and interoperability. I mean, you can exchange data and use data as long as there's a minimum of agreement on the data formats and the way those data are exchangeable. And also there, I mean, it's difficult to think that there will be the world standard, unique standard on doing this. But at the same time, a bit more of standardization in terms of data exchanges would be useful and necessary, again, to create positive externality. What we will do in the coming months, we will look at what in our jargon we call the refit of the open data framework, to look at those problems which I just mentioned. I mean, how the open data framework can be looked in a sort of modern way, looking at those cases where the exchanges are not necessarily public to private, but also private to public, or sometimes utilities to public. Because, for instance, in the present framework, utilities are not obliged to share data, but data which utilities have is immensely useful for many, many, many developers. So the world is rich of data, Europe is rich of data, but still we have probably to unlock all of this. Maybe a final word is about also the way you process those data. That's, of course, an issue about having the right infrastructure. And when you talk big, you need big infrastructure. And if you need big infrastructure, then you need big investment. And I'm particularly referring to the investments in artificial intelligence platforms and high-performance computing. Now, the idea is that here we think it's time that Europe gets a little bit more an act together. In particular, in high-performance computing, we have a bit lost the way. That's why, I mean, our next important proposal will be what we call the Euro High-Performance Computing Endeavor, which means getting all the actors, especially public actors, together to regain a little bit a place we deserve in the world in terms of high-performance computing. And high-performance computing should not be sort of cathedral in the desert, something that you put somewhere and no one can use it. So the whole idea is to put this kind of resources in a cloud space and making high-performance computing available to innovators, small enterprises. We have an impressive, we've, by the way, displayed this in Tallinn. We have an impressive amount of examples of companies using data and high performance computing as a service and innovating products, I mean, from shoe design to advanced drug design. Companies need high-performance computing, need data, but of course they don't have, for the majority of them, the scale to buy and own this kind of facilities. So the issue about shared facilities and working together, it's an issue that we want to take on. So to summarize, we want to create a free space where data can circulate freely. We want to have the minimum safeguard in terms of data exchanges, but without really, I mean, altering what they are, the normal functioning of the market. And we want to invest in data infrastructure. Thank you very much.